Right, we are live. Hello, everyone. Good morning. I'm Kelly Simek.
Justin Cruz here. We're going to take a few minutes to let everybody hop in and establish the feed and get everyone situated. But it'll be just a few minutes. Hopefully, you can hear us just fine as we welcome our viewers in our Q&A live stream from the National Weather Service's hurricane forecast for 2016.
And can you hear us? Let us know in the comments, because we can read your comments right now as well. So let us know if you need us to be closer to the camera.
So we're almost up to about 40 viewers. I think we can begin.
Yeah.
All right. Let's get right into it. And by the way, ask any question that you want. We see the comments on the bottom and we'll try to get to it as quickly as possible. First things first, I don't know if you can see from the back here, but the hurricane 2016 season outlook has 4 to 7 tropical cyclones, which is a significantly lower number from last year.
Yes, and that is in part due to the fact that we are likely going to be going into a La Nina event in the future. And so what that means is we're going to be seeing much cooler sea surface temperatures. Sea surface temperature is crucial in the formation of hurricanes. Warmer sea surface temperatures, the more likely we're going to see cyclones. So the fact that we're going to be seeing possibly lower sea surface temperatures, that's in part why we have a lower forecast of tropical storms numbers, at least for this season.
Okay, let's take a look at this graphic real fast here. So what we were in was El Nino, and that meant warmer waters. It also meant the upper level winds in a hurricane were much lighter, so that keeps hurricanes alive, keeps it thriving. Now we are going through La Nina, the complete opposite. It's more of a cooler water situation that Kelly was talking about a little bit earlier, and the upper level winds are much stronger. And when you have strong upper level winds, you can really shear apart a hurricane.
Yes, and so that is good news.
Yeah. Thank you, Lori. We're going to take a look at some comments. You can hear us fine. That's good. We are great. Prince asks, how are you?
Doing well. Thank you.
And Lori asks, is last year's El Nino completely gone? The good news is, yes, it is done. In fact, the water temperature is actually cooler than normal. It's wiped out, at least for some critical parts along the equatorial Pacific. So now that we have cooler water, it's going to be a lot tougher for hurricanes to form. It's going to be a lot tougher for hurricanes to thrive. And another important thing that the press conference and the officials always say is, hey, we can have a La Nina year and below average number of cyclones, but that one that comes out of nowhere and just happens to graze by the state or hit the state, that's what we all kind of worry about. Not so much the number of tropical cyclones in the season, because as you know, it's only going to take one.
Yes, and that's why it's so crucial to always be prepared no matter what numbers they put out. If there's a chance, no matter what. And one of the questions as well that we had gotten earlier was, can Hawaii be hit? It's a common myth that people believe that Hawaii is just completely safe. And that was actually one of the myths that Justin Cruz had busted in his special that he did.
Myth busting hurricanes. I will say this, since the satellite era, which is around 1970, only one island has been directly hit by a hurricane, and that would be Kauai. There might have been some storms in the 50s and in the past, but we weren't able to verify them as a hurricane or a tropical storm because we just didn't have satellite technology. But so far, only one island has been hit by a hurricane, that is Kauai. And if you remember Isel, that hit the Big Island as a weak tropical storm. So as far as we know, it's possible,
yes.
Absolutely. All islands could be under the gun, but Oahu has never been hit by a system. It's kind of an interesting note as well.
And one of our friends who's here today, a hydrologist for the National Weather Service, Kevin, he's one of our good friends, he actually put out this graphic where he took a composite of all of the storms that came into our basin during the last season. I'll post a picture of that on our Facebook. It was incredibly impressive that we didn't get hit. We
That's right.
got lucky. So I will show you that. It's basically just Hawaii completely in the clear, but it got close. And yeah, there's always a chance that it can happen. So that's why it's crucial to always be prepared. And again,
we got this close. We got this close last year.
Too close for comfort.
If you remember this, this was three systems. The one here is Kilo. The one in the middle is Ignacio. And the state is actually right down here. So that's how close we got. And then moving on, we also got Jimena. But this was this is an epic satellite shot of just what can happen. So of course, be prepared. For those that are just joining us, we're at about 131 viewers. The Central Pacific Hurricane Center has released their outlook for 2016. And what does it mean?
4 to 7 tropical cyclones. So that's better than last year. Mm-hmm. And that's all due to the fact that possibly we're going into a La Nina event. So good news on that front, but again, they're still in the forecast, so yeah, of course. So it's best to be prepared. And again, keep putting your questions. We're going to be answering any questions you have, whether it's in regards to the current forecast. So as of right now, there's a 40% chance that we could see an above average normal season. A 40% chance that we'll have a normal season, and then just a 20% chance that it will be below average season. But of course, that's still what we want.
So let's talk about rain for a minute, because one of the comments that was posted on this Facebook live stream is, okay, we kind of know a little bit about what we can expect for hurricane season and the wet season, because, you know, we're in a drought right now. The wet season, according to the hydrologist at the National Weather Service, and maybe we can get him to say a few words.
But check.
Yeah.
I'll go check.
Awesome. Awesome. The wet season. So it looks like initially, the wet season is going to remain on the dry side. We do expect a good amount of shower activity for the windward sides. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like a lot of that windward rain is going to get to the leeward spots, with the exception of Kailua Kona. Now, Kailua Kona is a different animal when it comes to weather in Hawaii, because Kailua Kona is the only place in the state that doesn't see trade winds on a consistent basis. So they actually, their wet season is during the summer, the dry season. So Kona rains are going to continue, windward showers are going to continue, but it doesn't look too promising for leeward areas that are already under some kind of drought, and that includes South and West Kauai, West Oahu, South Maui, the Lahaina areas of Maui as well, and parts of Lanai and West Molokai, and of course areas such as North Kona and the Kohala coastline might not see as much rain. So just a heads up on that. It is it's a situation where we're probably going to see a good amount of windward showers, but as far as the leeward areas, the main hope is that we'll see things like storm fronts, and we'll see things like cold fronts, upper level lows that will bring some rain as well. Okay, so let's take some questions. Do you think early, this is from Carl. Hey Carl, good to hear from you. Do you think early warnings are helping, or are people like, it won't hit us, and disregarding the warnings? I think they're helping because it keeps the weather top of mind, but there is some fatigue sometimes. So that's why it's important to not, you know, overhype weather events, and something that we won't do at Channel 2 here. Okay. Let's see, Kevin,
yes.
What's up,
yes,
man? Good to see you. Kevin Kodama, senior hydrologist at the National Weather Service Forecast Office in Honolulu. I was just talking about the wet season, and it's a little bit complex, this wet season, because some areas actually might see some drought relief and others might not.
Right.
So what areas will get probably minimal drought relief? Because a lot of people ask this.
More the leeward areas outside of Kona. Kona might actually improve because their wet season is actually the summer months.
Right.
And, you know, windward sides are going to be wet, we're expecting. But the leeward area, other leeward areas, so for instance, you know, Waianae, Alapepe, Ulupawakua, Kie, those areas, Lahaina, Even other areas of the Big Island, like, you know, South Kohala, you know, Kauai, these areas are dry, but they're just going to be really dry.
Right.
And Honolulu, of course, you know, we're not looking for a lot of drought relief. And, you know, this is not, you know, what is a possibility. So the last time we had a strong El Niño like this, it actually, even though it was followed by La Niña, it was followed by several years of dryness. But instead of a statewide drought, it became more regionalized.
I see.
So just the leeward areas.
So, you know, during the wet season for leeward areas, a significant source of rain are storm systems. There's
right.
polar lows that kind of dip and drag a cold front, upper level lows.
The lows, those kinds of things, yeah.
So, are we going to see more of those type of storm systems, you think, with the Niña in place, or will it be more just trade showers?
You know, that's interesting because, you know, in the past, we used to say, okay, El Niño dry and La Niña wet.
Right.
But one thing that's been interesting is that recent La Niña events have been trending dry.
Oh.
And
so that just throws a monkey wrench in
it. Yeah, it does. It does, actually. And so, you know, you can't just say, oh, we're having the flip side. And, you know, I was talking about the last time we had a strong El Niño back in 98, it was followed by 2 years in a row of La Niña, and we stayed dry.
Mm.
And so that was an example of how these La Niña events have been turning drier. And so, and right now, there's some mixed signals, and so it's really way too early to tell what the next wet season is going to be. You know, we're just trying to focus in on just what this dry season is going to look like. But if you look back in recent history, La Niña could stay dry.
Okay. So it's kind of a, we kind of hope for the best. But looking at trends historically, we can get a little bit of a picture of what we can get see this year. So windward sides, looks like you're in good shape. Leeward areas, we'll have to wait and see, depending on the amount of storms that move through. Okay, Glenn Castro has a question. And his question is,
were we ever hit by a hurricane in La Niña year?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, I want to say direct hit, I don't think so. Especially in recent history.
Yeah, because
if you look at the recent impacts, yeah. Isel, of course, wasn't. Iniki was El Niño, Ivo was El Niño. And so if you look back in the most recent hits, those were not La Niña years, but that doesn't mean we're not going to get hit. You know, you always prepare for the one. If that one has your number, you're going to get hit. And so you just, you know, with regards to these outlooks, you know, quite from my perspective, I don't pay attention to the numbers. Because we're just focusing on the one
that could potentially be. I'm going to take a detour here. And by the way, for the 120 viewers that are just tuning in right now, thank you. This is a live Facebook Q&A. We have Kevin Simon. We have Kevin Kodama from the National Weather Service. He's the chief hydrologist. I'm Justin Cruz. Let's talk about last night's rain, or yesterday's rain, for a quick moment, because that was spectacular. So we start, at least for a while, we start the day with it pouring in Kapolei all the way to Mokulahia, then it stops, pours on the windward side, and then that stops and kind of comes back to the west side. I mean, talk about perfectly timed rain as far as those drought areas. That must have been something that you were happy to see, that rain on the west side.
Yeah, it was. You know, it's just for this time, you don't usually expect that. Kind of make it count because they may not be seeing a whole lot more over the next several months.
Storms like that are very important. I am going to grab Chris. Oh yeah, he's actually being interviewed, so we're gonna talk to him next. Is there anything else that you wanted to add to that?
No, I mean, other than just, you know, take this time, as Chris was mentioning and as Vern was mentioning, take this time now to be prepared, get make those trips to Home Depot, Costco, whatever. And you stay prepared all year, because if you're prepared for a hurricane, you're gonna be prepared for just about any type of disaster, not, you know, natural and man-made. And so, you know, with hurricanes, you can see these things coming several days in advance. But yeah, there's some other types of disasters that you have absolutely no warning. You can't say, oh, this thing is coming, and then I can just go to Costco or whatever. You know, you need to be prepared now. And so, you know, stay prepared all the time.
Hey, Simon Woolley, thanks for a great question. A lot of people actually bring this up. Let's address his question.
Okay, so Simon's question is, how do Hawaii hurricanes interact with volcanoes?
That's a good question. Well, one thing that it does do is it enhances the rainfall. When a tropical cyclone hits, just like even in just a regular region, when it hits the mountains, it'll enhance the rainfall. But in terms of structure, you know, volcanoes won't prevent it from hitting. Isel was a good example. A volcano didn't stop it from hitting the Big Island. But it will affect the structure. You know, might disrupt the circulation of it. And depending on the strength of the system, it could actually, you know, gain its strength once it moves past the island. Now, that's for the Big Island.
Right.
Smaller islands, you know, Kauai, Oahu, speed bump, just run right over it.
So I think when Simon was asking that question, you could think of it in two ways. You can think of it as a mountain. How does that disrupt a hurricane? But what about the actual volcano itself? What about the emissions? Does that have any impact on hurricanes that are nearby? The actual, you know, Kilauea itself?
Yeah, that's a good question. I haven't seen any type of research saying it would. I would think it would be minimal.
Right.
Because, you know, especially if one comes in from the east, mm-hmm. and all the plume from Kilauea is moving west, it's moving away from the system. So the tropical cyclone won't be seeing any of the impacts prior to making landfall. It's not like that the two are coming together and they're all sort of moving in the same flow.
So to answer the question, both the volcano activity itself, Kilauea, or the mountain, Mauna Kea, Mauna Loa, have very minimal impact on the structure of a hurricane, especially a stronger hurricane system that is more put together and coming to the islands. Okay, another question. Dale, let's see what his question is.
Okay, Dale's asking, what can a person do if they live in a valley when a tropical cyclone hits? Well, of course, you always have to be prepared, have your kits ready. Not only do you want your food, water, supplies, but in a specific valley, first you want to make sure if you're in a high impact flood zone. So make sure you find evacuation routes. You should have a plan beforehand, but specifically in a valley, what would you recommend? It's good to know where to go if you need to get out of
it. Yes, I mean, you know, as Kelly mentioned, have a plan ahead of time, know what you're going to do, because if you know, like she said, if you're in a flood prone area, you want to be out of that flood prone area. But also, you know, in that kind of situation, you want to make sure that if you're going to shelter in place, you have to make sure that your facility, your home, or whatever it is adequate, is protected, is reinforced. If you're not going to stay at home, you need to know where you're going to go, know where your nearest shelter is. One thing about valleys, depending on the wind direction, you could actually see enhanced winds from a system, because when we do a forecast for a hurricane, it's for the maximum sustained winds and the gusts over the ocean. It doesn't account for the localized increases in the winds from terrain.
Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Think of it this way, when you're at the Pali Lookout and it's naturally a lot windier than, let's say, the Honolulu Airport, situations like that. So I think if you know your neighborhood well, and if you know that you're in a flood zone, maybe, you know, you should shelter in place at a different location. Okay, so let's take a few questions and we'll talk to Chris in a minute. Missed the prediction part. How many did you folks predict? Actually, let's go over here.
If you're just joining us, all right, we're going to walk over. So, again, we're going to be seeing now a less active season is predicted than we saw this past season. We just got over the most active hurricane season ever in the Central Pacific Basin. This is the outlook for this year. 4 to 7 tropical cyclones expected in the Central Pacific. There's a 40% chance we're going to be having an above normal season, a 40% chance that it's a normal season, and a 20% below normal. And I'm not sure. In the video, it looks inverted. Is it inverted for you guys?
It is.
Possibly. Okay, let's try to maybe, should we switch it?
Yeah.
All right, let's look. Okay. All right, and then we got to do this way. All right, so maybe that's no longer inverted for you. So this is what you're going to be seeing. All right, and now we're going to welcome in Chris Brinchley with the Weather Service and some Pacific Hurricane Center as well.
Correct. Right.
Yeah. Okay, so what can you tell us about this year? Why is it different? What all is the forecast? What is this month?
Well, last year, we had a very active El Nino season. This year, we're expecting a transition towards La Nina. That typically means less activity. However, we're looking at a longer cycle, what we call a decadal cycle, of more activity. So there's a little bit more uncertainty in the outlook for 2016. Less activity because of La Nina, but more activity because of the decadal cycle. And when we have that, there's a little more uncertainty. And again, the outlook calling for the year is a little bit more.
Okay, and then that's what we're seeing right now. So on average, La Nina does mean that there's less. And as you were saying, about 2.5 is the average cyclones that we would see in La Nina, but since we are seeing possibly a more active one, then the averages are about 6.5. They're what we have seen for the active La Nina. Okay, but what is the main message you want to get out to everyone, though, about this season?
Well, the main message is always going to be that we really want people to prepare for the coming season. We live in a very isolated island chain. We're far away from any assistance that will be able to come our way. So it's important that we all take each tropical cyclone season seriously, we prepare seriously, and that it only takes one to impact the state directly to cause some major impacts. You're going to want to have prepared well in advance, not a few days before, not even a week before, but even now before the season.
And so, one of the big messages is, although the numbers may be lower, that doesn't mean that you should change anything in your preparations. Always be prepared.
I wanted to point one thing out, because a lot of people are asking what La Nina is versus El Nino. If we can take a look at this graphic, I'm gonna point something out to you. See this blue area here? And it says minus 0.5, 1, 0, 0.5. The blue areas are showing cooler water temperatures in the equatorial North Pacific and in the East Pacific, as part of also into the Central Pacific. So we didn't have this blue before. It was like very dark. It was 2-3 degrees Celsius above average, but that's all flipped now, at least for this portion of the Pacific. Now the waters are actually cooler than normal. I never would have thought we would have seen this within 1 year of a record El Nino, but it has flip-flopped. So a little bit of encouraging news. Of course, don't let your guard down, but that's what we're looking at right now with the cooler waters. And with that, when we have that, that means it's harder for hurricanes to form and harder for them to stay alive. But you're going to hear us say this over and over again. It only takes one, right? So, Chris Brinchley, thank you so much.
Thank you.
He was representing the National Weather Service in the seasonal outlook today. I also want to thank Mr. Kevin Padama with the wet season outlook. It appears that everyone else has left the room and only Channel 2 is here. So, we want to thank our videographer from Cole for holding the camera. I think your arms are getting tired. And thank you, all of our friends that are watching online, the hundreds of you, and liking and commenting and things of that nature. If you have any other questions, just post it online, and we'll get to answering those questions a little bit later. But for now, Kelly needs to take a nap. She's had a long day from the morning show.
But before I go take a nap, I remembered one question from Victor, and that was, what should you have in your hurricane kit? The best thing is, just want to direct you real quickly to our K22 website. We have all of the things that you would need in your kits, also suggested plans. Make sure you have a plan. That is the main thing. We are heading into hurricane season. It starts next Wednesday, so it's best to always be prepared regardless. But now we do have the outlook, so we'll continue to answer your questions, but thanks, Victor, for that.
All right, good tip there. Thank you, Kelly. I appreciate you coming on our Facebook Live feed.
Yes.
Mahalo to all the commented and liked and all of our Facebook followers. We love you guys. I'm headed to work. She's headed to take a nap. I'm going to see y'all later. Aloha.
Aloha.